Glad to have everybody here tonight. I'm Jen. I'm a grateful believer, and I struggle with codependency, depression, anger, and childhood sexual abuse. I'm glad to be here. Super nervous, so I'm just going to stick to reading, because I have a hard enough time with that. All right. So, when I was younger, I was a rather shy and quiet kid. I observed everything around me like it was a movie. I found it very hard to participate with others socially. School was a nightmare. Surprisingly, I hid the fact that I could barely read until I was in third grade. I was deeply embarrassed by my dyslexia. For as long as I can remember, I have felt uneasy. These feelings didn't always come from a giggle or a hurry up from other students. A lot of the times it was just me and my own body feeling nervous. Taking turns reading a lesson chapter was the worst. I'd asked to use the restroom and hoped by the time that I got back, they had forgotten that I didn't take a turn. Just when I think I was in the clear, the teacher would call on me. After correction, impatient sighs, and total humiliation, I always went from being the observer to being the watch, judged, and criticized. I know I'd never be good enough. After all, I didn't even have the ability to learn correctly. I'd wear a fake smile a lot of the time and try as I could to please as many people as I could around me. I desperately wanted to feel accepted by others and have real friends, not just the ones that kind of talked to me if I said had brought them a toy or something. Shortly after the third grade is when I started feeding my feelings. It's been a struggle ever since to not to look to food. Praise the Lord, since recovery, I've lost almost 160 pounds. You surely have heard, for a child's perception is reality, even if that perception is flawed. And I grew up believing that my dad disliked me and that my mom was too distracted or too busy with her own obligations. I was labeled a liar by my dad, who always demanded respect and spoke with harsh, critical words. I was to act right and do better. Like any kid, I'd say I didn't do something I know dang well that I did. But I even confessed to things that I didn't do so that the accusations and the questioning would stop. I hated that pressure. Growing up in a military home, you realize fast that you are a brat that needs to learn how to carry yourself and act right. It makes for good appearance. It makes for the good appearance of a great family. Well-behaved children with self-respect, however, behind closed doors, I don't think anyone was ever at ease, not even my dog, when my dad was home. Things would seem fine, then my parents would yell. I'd hear my brother getting another spanking, some deserved and some not. He would get most of the physical punishment when we were younger, and I would get more of the verbal punishment. Slow down. Did you even chew that? That's why you're getting fat. Nobody's ever going to believe you if you keep lying, Jennifer. I can still hear those sometimes today. Those discouragements are hard to deal with when you're young. I don't want to leave out the fact that there were good times in my childhood. When my parents seemed happy, and we always had a roof over our head, soft bed, food, nice clothing, and good Christmases. However, there's a lot of memories that start off really good and terrible. It's burning the bottom of an omelet. You try to salvage what looks not too bad, only to take a bite and discover it leaves such a bad taste in your mouth, just as what you had deemed trustworthy would. It sounds harsh, but it was my truth for a long time. I was struggling with an anxious soul and had not learned about resting in the Lord, the Lord's truth. I found in Philippians 4:6, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. I didn't want to make anyone mad, and I didn't want to feel more rejection. I got enough of that while trying to make friends every time we moved, and I got enough of that trying to spend time with my dad. I was close with my mom when I was little. A special memory that I have was watching her lips as she would read to me. I could see patience and love in her face as she tried desperately to connect the dots with these misleading sounds you people call vowels. She even waited for the truth when I had lied, and most of the time she could get honesty to come out of my mouth. She loved animals, a trait that she passed on to me. Over time, we disconnected. I could tell that she was sad a lot, and I felt responsible. Maybe I wasn't the kid that she wanted anymore. Maybe I didn't make her happy because I wanted to go outside and play and not finish my chores correctly. Something was happening between my mom and my dad. They'd yell and eat at each other often, and I heard loud bangs and my mom crying. I would be scared and very angry. I knew there was nothing that I could do to stop it. The next day there would be holes in the walls and the doors with no real answer as to what had happened. At times my mom wasn't my mom at all. I can clearly remember once sitting at the top of the stairs with my brother, listening to her cry and tell my dad that she didn't have children. There was another instance when she filled a giant bowl almost of an entire gallon of milk. She was laughing, sitting on the floor and speaking in a childlike voice, but being very rough with our beloved kitten, almost drowning it in the milk when it wouldn't drink. When I screamed at her and tried physically to stop her, my dad rushed in and pushed me to the ground and yelled with curse words, "Leave her alone, she's crazy and she's unfit to be your mother." At that point, I couldn't understand the enemy attacks on a person's mind or depression. All I heard was my dad yelling. All I heard was my dad telling me that the only dependable adult in my world was unfit. When my dad wasn't deployed, he wanted to be left alone. He was frequently angry. He violated my emotions, my trust, and my body. I mentioned a few times to my mom that I felt uncomfortable around my dad because he had been touching me. He assured her that I was just dramatic and on occasions that it was just an accidental touch. I knew that was a lie, but I tried to convince even myself otherwise. A few years later, I was fully aware that the fondling wasn't an accident. It was a choice, and most of my friends' dad didn't go through these things. While I was unsure if that was just the way it went for some families, I hated that it was a part of mine. One day, my dad finally confessed that he had a problem. He cried a little and said that he would get help. This turned into the normal cycle without resolution for many, many years. Feeling all used up, unprotected, and vulnerable at home didn't help me focus on schoolwork. I tried desperately not to be seen or heard, which is very difficult when you have health issues and you keep finding pornography in your book bag where you're pulling out your homework. In my mind, I blamed the dumb boys in my class, but deep down, I always knew that it was my dad. Anger and stress was building inside over the sexual abuse and him dividing our family by manipulating everyone or downplaying the seriousness of his offenses. I mustered up the courage one day after a boy asked me to an eighth grade dance. I was going to confront him about it. When I saw him at the computer, I walked up behind him and saw him photoshopping my face onto a provocative swimsuit model. Confusion, shame, and guilt with a big dose of fear came over me that moment, and I just cowered away. Jeremiah 31:25 says, "The Lord will refresh the weary and satisfy the faint." Growing up, one of the ways God refreshed my weary heart was by giving me time alone with my big brother. I annoyed him, but he still let me tag along most of the time. Exploring with him in foreign lands, orchards full of fruit and giant butterflies, crossing dead trees covered in neon moss that had fallen over the deep trenches from the German war, being distracted with fire, and even putting poop from our dog in our neighbor's mailbox together made me feel alive. He demanded respect with his seemingly fearless attitude and carefree personality. I didn't have to worry when I was with him. I probably should have, but I didn't. Not even a million scraped knees, bruises, or even the accidental third burn on my lap that had me in the hospital for 6 weeks couldn't keep me from knowing that he loved me just for me. Nature has always been a place where, even before I knew my Savior, I felt him. Romans 1:20 says, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature has been clearly seen, because being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." Over time, I turned into an angry, rebellious teenager. Nobody really wanted to be around me at this point. My parents divorced, and for a moment, I thought life was going to get better. Not having to look over my shoulder while showering or changing, no more wondering if the lock on my door would work this week or was mysteriously broken again, or if the dresser in front of my door would keep me safe. My mom fell deep into depression at the thought of her 22-year marriage ending, and my brothers seemed angrier than ever with my dad's absence. I felt heavy resentment in the air. After all, I was the one who kept shining a light on the ugly truth about the head of my home. I felt like me being honest hurt everyone more than just keeping it inside. Why wasn't I strong enough to keep this inside? I carried the responsibility of the brokenness of my family, and I just didn't want to exist. I felt if I was not in the picture, my parents would get back together and my brother could have his dad back. In time, my sibling would get over the loss of me. I got several piercings, which later led to a habit of cutting myself to numb the pain and relieve the hurt. It got me the attention and acknowledgement from doctors that I needed support and that I was emotionally damaged, I needed help and support for the emotional damage that I had never had from the outside world. At this time, I'm not sure if I was really ready to die. Telling people that I had thoughts about it got me a sure ticket out of the four empty walls that were crumbling down upon the three of us, turning us into enemies that would lash out at each other and sometimes cause physical harm. The police would be called at times and come in and deem me and my attitude responsible. According to them, I wasn't hurting, but defiant and needed correction to make me act right and grateful for my life. I wasn't grateful for my life. I couldn't find one thing that made giving up worth it. I was having moments of blacking out and losing control of my anger. And this caused my hands to do unthinkable things. In a moment of pure rage, I took out all of my anger and pain and strangled my brother's cat. He had since he was little. I wanted my brother to lose all of his love for me so that when I was gone, that he'd be a little happy about it. I carried this guilt knowing the truth and the harm that I had added. I asked God to forgive me and in the same breath told him that he owed me a place in heaven for the raw deal in life that he had given me. At 14, I was really ready to be done with life. After sitting in the bathroom for hours, I decided I was going to take whatever pills I could find, and just to make sure, I would take them all. A few minutes later, I felt horrible, and there was a knock at the door. "What are you doing in there? I heard you crying earlier, but I didn't know what to say. But now I really have to pee. So can I come in? Or can you come out?" I was going to die, and I was calm, and I was okay with it. Why did a feeling of hope come over me? In that moment, I was able to open the door and say to my brother, "I don't know what's wrong with me, but I took all the pills in here, and I'm sorry." The last things that I remember was him saying, "Why would you do that? Are you stupid? I can't lose my sister, too. I'm calling Mom or 911. Everything was a blur after that. I woke up the next day and to my mom's face and the doctor saying that I was going to be okay and that they were gonna get me help. I was angry that I wasn't dead and upset that nobody was making my mom accountable for her behavior. I was in treatment for a while. Things seemed to be getting better, but I was so fearful to go home and be forgotten again that right before discharge, I would say the magic words, "Oh, I don't want to live." And they'd borrow my shoelaces and I'd get to stay a little bit longer. Over time, I learned some coping skills as far as denying the urge to shower many times a day and the cutting stopped. When my mom and my brother came to visit, my brother said they were going to church regularly and doing better. I wanted to be a part of that because I could see a little change in them. I went to church and gave my heart to God many times, I thought. I said the right things. I knew I needed him, but I didn't trust that he was all good or loved me like others said that he did. Why would he anyways? I was promised I'd find healing and forgiveness, but I didn't know what that meant or how. But I thought I did, so I tripped straight over myself and tried mending my relationship with my dad when he was going to counseling because I felt I'd look terrible if he was finally admitting his wrongdoings and I stayed a resentful person. I thought it would also make it more comfortable for my brother who wanted a relationship with him still. I tried the church thing for a while, seeking relief from the emotional wounds. I wanted the God all these people said that they had, especially the one my brother said I needed. But every time someone referred to God as my father, pure rage would fill my heart. Why did you give me this childhood, a scrambled brain, and then parents that would let me fall this far in despair before I even had a chance to thrive? Psalms 27, 10, and 13 reads, "Though my father and my mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." As I got a little older, I turned to older men for attention. I wanted to feel grown up and in control, but since I was neither of those, I was easily manipulated into uncomfortable situations. I chat online, and it would always turn into a lustful mess, so I tried to stay away from that. The first guy that I shared a little bit of my family dysfunction with said that I didn't deserve being treated like that, but then he also forced himself upon me. I was 14. I said no, and he tried to overpower me and shame me for leading him on. That experience supported the fact that I wasn't worthy of respect. This all happened while my mom was helping his pregnant wife get groceries. I went a year to Christian school. I really thought it was punishment, but I believe now that it was my mom's attempt to say that I want to help you, but I just don't know how. I was still unwilling to really believe God cared about me now. Now I was in a school with a group of people that were supposed to be helpful and loving, but they weren't at all. They thought they were better than me and avoided me, yet still had time to gossip about me. The first panic attack that I've ever experienced in my life was after hearing, "I think that's the girl that slept with her father." I went back to public school. It seemed a little better because there was a good mix of the good kids and the bad kids, but I dropped out from the stress-related issues. I started hanging out with another guy that was too old for me, drinking and smoking pot, a lot of pot. The more my mom forbid, the more I ran to him for comfort. In my mind, she had her chance to care for me, to protect me, and now that ship had sailed. When I couldn't even share how I felt under the supervision of a counselor without being talked over, I was done even trying to mend this relationship. I still had no relationship with God. I couldn't force myself to believe God was any less neglectful of his children than my earthly father because of what he had allowed. Anyone that tried to reassure me that the Lord was for me, I just put on my blinders and distanced myself from them. I didn't want to be reminded that I had shortcomings. Besides, I believed I wasn't responsible for how, before who I had become. And if people love me, they would have to just deal with my attitude and be grateful that I didn't turn out worse. I was so closed off and resentful that I just needed one area filled, and that was my need for affection, attention, and relationship with someone. I completely blocked out the negatives this man was doing, acted oblivious to the drug deals, played the part of his young side chick. I was so delusional to believe that this was love. After my mom couldn't get me to stop seeing him, I didn't want to be under her roof anymore. She needed some place to send me, and I wasn't going back to the hospital. She sent me to live at a girl's home instead. I couldn't have contact with him, but I worked my way around that on a few occasions. A third party told me that he was working hard and trying to get a car in his own place, and he was going to come and rescue me. The weeks went by without hearing anything from him or about him. Being around girls my age had me thinking maybe I should be a kid while I still had the chance. I was excited for days waiting for a doctor's appointment to have a physical so that I could enroll back in school and leave this dumb romance in the past. Nothing would stop me from now seeing I needed to enjoy the rest of high school and plan for my future with a positive attitude. Nothing could bring those feelings to a halt faster than a nurse telling me your pregnancy test came back positive. What pregnancy test? Surely you're mistaken. When did I have a pregnancy test? I asked. When you peed in the cup for your physical? I went in a few days later for an ultrasound. I was already 16 weeks pregnant. The nurse and I did the math, and the last time that I could have gotten pregnant was on my 16th birthday. Happy birthday, you're gonna be a teen mom and have to give your baby to a stranger because you're gonna be viewed as an unfit mother too. It was either that or my dad's suggestion, just do what my niece did, have an abortion. But Psalms 139:13 tells us, "You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knitted it together in my mother's womb. I was a wounded soul, but I couldn't add murder to an already growing rap sheet." Within days of finding out that I was pregnant, the police came to the girl's home and asked me a few questions. I was honest that I hadn't talked to him in a long time, that I assumed that we were over anyways, and that yes, we did have a consensual sexual relationship. I said nothing about being pregnant. They didn't ask, and I was still in shock. I figured maybe that he was just getting talked to about his relationship with a minor. That very week, I did my normal thing, denying reality, just sticking to a routine. I went to go get the paper and bring it in for the cook lady to read. On the front page, I saw his face. It read, "Stolen car, check fraud, and suspect arrested for murder." I dropped to my knees, vomiting and overwhelmed. Few words came out for days. I didn't have the strength to do anything. I was a shell of a person for a while. I just slept, was supplied with high-powered antidepressants, and even then it was still easy to close myself off. Fast forward a few years, I got my GED before my friends even graduated, and I had a beautiful daughter that softened my heart. I wasn't such a terrible mom after all. My relationships weren't perfect, but they definitely were getting better. I started going to church with my friend and questioning at the altar why I wasn't experiencing God as others said that they did. I told him I always knew that he was there. I knew that he saw the hurt that I had faced. He was there when my daughter was born and I was scared to death. He was there through my divorce after attempting to build my own fake family because I was still holding on to feelings of inadequacy and the idea that my daughter needed an earthly father too. Boy, was my idea of love still messed up at this point. I struggled back and forth with going to church. My life was a cycle of blaming God, demanding Him to help me, and then when I felt unanswered, I'd go in for more counseling and a different antidepressant. After losing a little weight, I'd feel a little bit better about myself. My actions reeked of self-pity, pride, and self-protection. And the man that I picked this time secretly hatched up a plan from a wealthy pothead friend of ours to have college students needing extra money do porn for a website. He brought this idea to me in the light of our financial problems would soon be over. We would be stress-free, we would have the money for our bills, and to buy all the pot that we ever needed. I was poor, struggling, not making good choices, and honestly wanted the fact that we watched porn to stay a secret. I would never agree to be part of something like this, yet by even watching, I was. I tried to explain how wrong I thought it was, and how it promoted sexual addiction, and how it tears families apart. My blood started to boil, because in saying it out loud, a wave of, oh no, Jen, you're letting this become you too. So as quickly as those thoughts came in, I followed it with a twist of blame. He knew my childhood. How could he do this, and why wouldn't he understand? Why would he even think that I'd be on board with this? After my sudden disapproval of his plan, he started becoming more controlling and abusive. I did humble myself and pray to God to get me out of it. I lost everything that I own besides two bags of me and my daughter's clothing and a few toys and my doll. It was a giant blow to say the least. However, God protected us from any further harm, and my heart began to heal over the losses and my own mistakes. I moved back to Alabama, and the atmosphere was so painful. Bad memories of everywhere I turned. I felt like a single mom burden on others. I couldn't shut those feelings off all the way. My mom was doing a lot better. My brother and my sister-in-law were busy with their families, but they were very supportive, and I did know that they loved me and my daughter. But I still saw times when my brother was struggling to overcome being the product of my father's anger. I wanted so badly to fix him and give good advice, but I didn't even know how to fix myself. I met a nice Christian guy with such a kind heart and a great listening ear. Our relationship grew over deep conversations of our personal struggles, and we even talked about Jesus openly and prayed for each other. I loved my family, but I wanted to see if this was the one. He was. I got married after a 1-year engagement before we found out we were going to be a family of three. That's Gabe. We were happy and excited, and almost everything seemed to go well. I felt safe. I really had never been happier in my life. After having our son, we knew something wasn't right with his health. After countless doctor's appointments, the dismay really forced us to find a supporting second family in a church called Faith. Because we knew emotionally that we couldn't do it alone, and we had both had a guilty conscience of not giving God the glory for all the blessings that He had brought into our life. We pushed through the stress of our baby having open heart surgery at 2 years old. The moment that he was mended, it was 6 months of protecting him from himself. We thought we were both being strong as parents and spouses. I hadn't smoked in years. But I wanted to save him, and he wanted to save me from extra pain, but we couldn't. My pain, depression, and closed-offness came back when Pete admitted to me that he had been self-medicating with narcotics on and off since he was a teenager, not just when our son had surgery. I felt betrayed. I had shared so much about myself honestly with him, and he kept this from me under the excuse that he didn't want to add any more harm to me as a person. Because of my rejection issues, I had placed high expectations on him. When he couldn't fulfill them, I took it personal. When the hurts would come up, I felt out of control, so then I'd get high. I justified this with, well, my kids are asleep, this is not a part of their life, and I really didn't seek the Lord for his comfort, and I knew better than that. I believed I knew better, sorry. Pete started counseling with Greg, a care pastor at our church in PA. I was hesitant in joining when I was invited many times because I had enabled him for so long, and living in sin myself. I would fight with him hard until he would tell me the truth, and then when I got it, I couldn't handle it. The anger and resentment blinded me from my part in the dysfunction of my marriage. When I started to see I wasn't coping and my counseling and self-medicating wasn't helping, I said, okay, let's go hear what a crappy wife I am and how I failed and how I made everything worse. To my surprise, I was validated in the fact that I did love my husband deeply, that I had done some things right, but that it wasn't my job to fix him or try to control anything within someone else or set him on the path that I thought that he should be on. I was done, spent, and exhausted anyway from feeling responsible for pushing him to fix himself anyway. I didn't want to play the parental role to him anymore, and that didn't mean that I was a bad wife. It just meant that I craved boundaries. I was told that I was important and my own issues deserved some badly needed attention, and he saw hope for Pete and I both separately and joined together. Pastor Greg had already started planting some seeds, letting us know that we would never be enough to fix each other, and suggested celebrate recovery. I don't know what day or month, but it was sometime at the end of 2009 or early 2010 is when we started. I went because Pete needed support that wasn't solely on my shoulders. I kind of just wanted him to get help with his hurts and seek God, so there wasn't so much destruction in our lives. I really just wanted his load off my shoulders so that I could just be responsible for keeping my screws tightened, suppress my anger, and muzzle my mouth, and sleep like I was in a coma. It took me coming to CR two times before I knew that I was a wreck in my own thinking. Then I spent years and years trying to understand why I was the way that I was, and felt the need to babysit my dad and relationships that he had with women with children, and how the hurts affected me. Why I was attention seeking for many years, and how counseling without real goals just made me think I knew it all and kept me in a constant loop of thinking about the abuse and how it had changed who I was supposed to be. That's great breeding grounds for staying stuck in resentment. That's what makes me appreciate Celebrate Recovery so much and working the steps with my sponsor. It truly helped me gain a new perspective on what living really means. I believed that I wasn't lovable and not worthy of healing. I sat through large group wondering if Pete was even listening, and then through a couple small groups pretending to have nothing to say. The guidelines kind of scared me. I came back again and again until I found myself sharing honestly. I said a few bad words here and there, and nobody kicked me out or rejected me. But then I found myself committed to a step study and had a sponsor encouraging me to work the steps. She let me vent and she let me ask questions. Trudy, this amazing woman of God, let me openly struggle with trusting her with my moral inventory without taking offense. God used her to help me not deny the mistakes that I had made. She showed me the embodiment of Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. When I admitted that my pain, the things that I had done, things that had happened to me, When I admitted my pain for things that had happened to me and the things that I had done to others was greater than my fear of the future, it allowed me to surrender my hurts and my pride and ask God to help me renew my mind and make lifestyle changes centered in Him. He never left me when I had to face consequences for breaking down trust in my marriage by speaking to my ex. He never left me when I desperately clawed through walls of denial to find my part, take accountability, and make amends. This year alone, He never left me when news of Grammy's death hit. I wasn't enough to console my husband, but the Lord is. He was there when I got the message that a dear friend of mine had passed away from an overdose. And He was there when we lost our babies in March. When I struggle to find peace with things the way they are, a bunch of loose ends, unanswered questions, or uncertainty of the future, I know God's grace is enough. It's enough to keep restoring my marriage. It's enough to keep me trying, it's enough to keep me learning, it's enough to keep me giving. The more I step out and say, the past can't change, I accept it. Sometimes it hurts. You can't get over what you don't own, and the greatest starting place for authentic faith is honesty. Faith isn't a feeling, it's a decision. The more I come out of disobedience and take suggestions from my sponsor and the Lord's word on how He wants me to conduct myself, regardless of how I feel, the more my heart softens and the more I fall in love with the only one who has the power to love me at my worst unconditionally and pick me up when I fall. I am powerless apart from Him. I am selfish, resentful, fearful, and nothing is manageable. Deliverance from strongholds in my life has always come after a season of trusting Him and stepping into action, the action of leaning into Him. I have learned to deny the fight or flight response my sinful nature so easily tries to entangle me in. Being deeply rooted in His love and taking the next right step of action. I didn't learn how to do this just by simply coming to large group. I learned this by one-on-one time working the program with my personal sponsor. When with Him, I'm no longer stuck in agony under the surface with redundant question of my self-worth or my purpose. One of my favorite verses is Romans 8:28. And my interpretation of it is that God didn't create us for failure, nor to be full of feelings of inadequacy. Of course, we will fail at times as we learn our identity in Him. But if we trust Him, He will sculpt even our mistakes and restore them to be used for His good. Another is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And always submit to Him and He will make your path straight. I choose to no longer gamble my sanity and well-being on what I think is best for me, materialistic things or substances that prolong my suffering. He brought me out of darkness and the deepest of gloom, and He broke away my chains. He wrote that for me long before I was born. I need guidance, support, real friends, and accountability. True restoration started coming when I stopped overcomplicating everything, started taking accountability for my part, and stopped trying to control everything else. I welcome the Almighty. I want to be pleasing before Him more than anything else. When the devil pipes in with discouragement, I shut it down through rejoicing in my Father's promises, filling myself with more of His word, and reaching out to my safe relationships with the people that God has blessed me with, like my sweet Southern sponsor, Amy. I count every woman here my accountability buddy. I know God has the best plan for my life. He has used Celebrate Recovery to revive my identity and is still helping me rebuild healthier relationships as I step into service work here every Friday night and within the church. I am becoming a better and more supportive wife as I learn my responsibilities as the assembly coach here at Harvest Celebrate Recovery. Recovery alongside my husband. Sorry, that was all choppy. If shame and guilt from your own or someone else's sin is consuming you, telling you that you have no purpose, that your struggles have been for nothing, and that you're too broken or dirty to be loved, or part of God's plan, that's a lie. Jesus understands your grief. He understands your shame and your pain, and he wants to restore you. Service work here is not about people pleasing or trying to earn your keep. It's not that at all. It is the way, however, that he has given me confidence in his power to equip me among accountability, support, and encouragement. There are different service opportunities here to fit different personalities, and I encourage you to ask anyone with a name tag what they do here and how you can be a part of it. Only God's grace and peace can carry us through times of trial, whether it's physical or emotional or both. When the pressure seems like too much and I just want to give up, the calling in my heart to God-given responsibilities are always overpowering. I choose to stay faithful even when I don't feel like it. My brothers and my sisters, lost, wounded souls, rejected and anxious souls, God sees you. He knows what you need, and he calls you his child. I see you. Keep coming back. Don't let fear, shame, anger, or rebellion control your free will. Make the choice to break the cycle and let God take the lead. Psalms 1:1-3 promises us. Oh, the joy of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked or stand around with sinners or join in with mockers, but they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. They are like trees planted along the river banks, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all that they do. Thanks for letting me share.